than half a century ago, the city of Sydney was gripped by questions over who was leaving the word eternity in beautiful copper plate scripts like this, in yellow chalk on the pavement. And it later turned out that the person leaving these messages was a former drunk and petty criminal called Arthur Stace, who'd been inspired by a powerful church sermon about where to spend eternity. But there's so much more to this incredible story, and we are thrilled to be joined this morning by the woman whose family welcomed him in, Elizabeth Meyers, as well. Welcome, Elizabeth. As well as the co-author of this new book, Mr. Eternity, Roy Williams.
Hey. Welcome.
Welcome to both of you. Roy, what an incredible story.
It's a great Australian story, Natasha. It's got everything. So this bloke lived through both the economic depressions, both the world wars. He was a down and out, a virtual derelict before his conversion in 1930, the height of the Great Depression, and then completely turned his life around.
Wow.
And one of the things he did was for 35 years, every day, he went out in the dawn hours and wrote Eternity in chalk on the pavements of Sydney.
And for decades, no one knew who was leaving these strange, ethereal, cryptic messages for everyone. For more than 25 years,
they were very familiar, though.
Yeah, that's...
How did your family get to know him, Elizabeth?
Well, my father was invited to be the minister at the Burton Street Baptist Tabernacle, and I was 10 years old. And when we came to the church, Arthur was one of the church members. Mm-hmm. He and his wife were there, and they were very involved and a really intricate part of the community there, and lovely people. And that's how my father first met Arthur. And it was not long after that he was out with Arthur and he followed him around a corner and saw him bend down and write Eternity. And he said to himself, no one could do that well without having done it before. So he said to Arthur, are you Mr. Eternity, Arthur? And he said, guilty, Your Honour. And then he said, you won't tell anyone though, will you? Because he really didn't want people to know.
Why?
Well, he was very humble, very shy. And to him, it was all about getting the message out. He didn't want any publicity or notoriety. And at that stage, he'd been doing it for 19 years and no one knew who he was.
Oh, gosh.
And so then my father thought, oh, this is a good story. I've got to talk him into getting this out. So gradually, Dad got to know him, learnt all about his sad life. There was a lot that he didn't tell people initially. And he was embarrassed about some of his family who were still alive. He didn't
want
to...
But Elizabeth, didn't he get didn't he feel he got a message from God when he was listening? He was in church, he was listening to a sermon or something, and he heard the word eternity.
That's
right.
And
it impacted on him?
It did. It was 2 years later, after he'd become converted, he went along to the same church. They had a mission on, and he heard a famous Baptist evangelist called John Ridley, and he preached about eternity. Echoes of Eternity was the name of the sermon. Oh. And so he, at the end of the sermon, he shouted out. He was one of the old-time preachers, you know, who used a fire and brimstone type speaker. Mm. And he said, oh, that I wish that I could shout the word eternity over the streets of Sydney.
Oh.
And Arthur felt that God spoke to him about that.
Wow.
And when the service was finished, Arthur felt in his pocket and he had a little piece of chalk. And he walked out to the corner of the church and he bent down and he wrote eternity in this beautiful copper plate. He'd never written it before ever. He said he didn't think he even knew how to spell it. And it was like it was a really inspired from God to write this word. And so from then on, he went out every day. In the early hours of the morning, he'd get up at 4 a.m., he'd pray and ask God where to go. And he felt that God led him to different suburbs. And so then he would spend up to 4 hours doing it every morning and it'd be home by breakfast time.
And no one knew.
And no one knew.
Now, Roy, when you wrote the book, what else did you find out?
Oh, many things, Denise. Mm-hmm. I mean, one thing is we found out where he learnt to write in that copperplate style. It was almost certainly at Goulburn Public School in the 1890s because he was a foster child. His mother gave him up. Yeah, his mother gave him up when he was just 7 years old. And he spent his next 7 years with a middle-aged lady. Then he worked down a coal mine for a few years on the south coast of New South Wales. And then he came back to Sydney. He worked, among other things, for his own sister's brothel in Surrey Hills. He went off to World War One as a stretcher bearer and came back, like so many Australian men, broken, shell-shocked. He became a drunk in the 1920s. And then, as I say, he turned it all around. It's just a wonderful, heartwarming story.
It is. It's so magical too. There's something sort of metaphysical about it. What was he trying to tell people? What was the message?
His message was an evangelical Christian message. So very orthodox about Christ's judgment in the afterlife. But the amazing thing is that the message has resonated with so many people. There was New Year's Eve 1999, of course. Yeah. It was on the Harbour Bridge. And then a whole new generation of young people have learnt about his story, and the word itself, with all its connotations of the meaning of time, human mortality, all these things.
He was doing this anonymously. He was doing this in the smallest sort of possible way, so people looking down at their feet would see it on the pavement in front of them.
You used to go to railway stations.
That's right.
It was a
tiny, small little thing, an incredible intimate moment he's trying to create with someone that no one else would be part of. What do you think he would have made of putting eternity in giant lights on the Harbour Bridge, watched by millions of people on New Year's Eve at the turn of the millennium? What would he have actually thought
about? He'd be chuckling. He had a great sense of humour. He'd be going, what's this? What's this cove? What's happening?
Getting your message across,
though. It looked fantastic. I mean, it looked fantastic on the bridge on that New Year's Eve. But I'm just thinking, you know, we're not as religious. Society is not as religious as it once was. How do you think Arthur's message, or what do you think he'd feel about today's society? Would his message still have the same impact, the same meaning for so many people?
I think he'd still want to write the message, wouldn't he, Roy?
Yes.
Certainly things have changed. There's not as many people going to church or as religious as they were. But he believed God gave him that message, and I think he would continue to do it. And I think he would be... Well, at first, as Roy said, he would just shake his head and said, I don't believe this, you know. But then he would be thrilled to think that it was there.
And what's that there on
your
piece?
Well, this here is an original eternity that he wrote for my mother.
Oh, you're kidding!
No.
That's a unique part of Australian history, because it's an eternity... and it's signed by Arthur himself.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my God.
It's one of only three that are existing now.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Do you know what? I think his message is more important than ever.
Yeah.
Don't you?
I agree.
Yes.
I agree.
What a great story.
Did you know it's gone around the world too? Not just Australia. There's a cafe in Moldova in the old Eastern Bloc called the Eternity Cafe.
Wow.
Named after Arthur.
Do you think there'll be a copycat person
There always have been, Denise. There were copycats in Arthur's time, people who tried to claim the credit. In the Sydney Morning Herald and other papers.
Wow.
But it was Arthur.
Yeah.
And that just speaks volumes about Arthur. He wasn't interested in the publicity of the notoriety. He just wanted to spread a very, very important message.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
And Roy and Elizabeth's book is called Mr. Eternity. It is such an extraordinary story of Arthur Stace. It's available now through the website MrEternity.com, or the phone number to order it is now on your screen. There it is, 02-9857-4477. What a great story. Thank you so much for joining us this week.
Thank you for having me.